territory. And so anyway, so he was basically the first player who made this on a consistent basis, you know, of this. You know, so the... I know maybe it's kind of... I mean, it's lives, you know, and the fates of people, you know, but there was this common joke, you know, going on that, well, Junge was probably captured and tortured into giving away all the variations. So then the, how otherwise could Botvinnik learn all this stuff, you know, who could tell him? But then... no, well, the fortunes of war, what can you do? Anyway, so... And this variation, you know, that's just huge, huge, you know, analytical research. I remember when I made my breakthrough, you know, in the early 1980s, and I started playing in the Soviet Union on the national championship level on the different stages, the semifinals and the first league, trying to qualify for the Premier League, which never happened, by the way. This is what I encountered, you know, a lot of people were so booked up. And nobody played this stuff in our local tournaments. And it's like this, it was very difficult to pick up this stuff, you know, like this books, you know, they had some games, but, you know, the complexity of the resulting positions without a deep analysis done on your own and over a period of time was almost impossible to enter this and survive against good players. I resisted, you know, I avoided this stuff. It actually cost me, you know, a lot of games where I basically was giving away the white pieces because I couldn't. And then Kasparov, you know, he was crushing people on the white side of this, obviously, and others. No, well, finally I was able to overcome my fear slowly. And by the mid-1980s, you know, I started venturing into the stuff with white. And then one day I played the young Ivanchuk. So Ivanchuk was only 16 years old, Vasily Ivanchuk, right? So he was already, well, had the... He already had lots of good results and was generally billed as the rising star, you know, and the future world champion or anything. And we ventured into the stuff. Maybe one day I'll show you this game. It was insane. And at some moment, you know, he captured my bishop with his bishop. And then captured my rook, and I was busy doing something else. So I was like a rook and a bishop down. And then I got my material back, almost all of it, but couldn't get much more than a perpetual check. It was a landmark game. To this day, I don't know how I survived this encounter, you know. So. It was also very interesting during the game when I was I was just working out this concept, which I found so hard to believe. I spent like hour and a half to come up with this, and I was really nervous getting low on time. And he was answering instantly. And when I did this on the board, he kept on answering instantly. And I thought, Jesus, you know, so he analyzed everything, so I'm dead, right? Then I play this check, and he has only two king moves. And I already was not in a position to calculate any deeper. I was just playing moves on my intuition. And I was trying to make him think a little bit so I can catch up with my calculations, right? And I got more than I bargained for. He sat there for over an hour with the choice of two moves. And it's like, I was very happy. Then I couldn't understand what was going on. Because I thought I played, before that I played some speculative moves, which he answered instantly. Then I play what I thought was the only move, a check, and now he's, no, well, anyway. So by the time, you know, he was halfway in his calculations, I already saw that one king move was very bad and was losing by force. So then the next half an hour, I don't really know what he was thinking for. After the game, he told me he was calculating what could have happened if he played a different move, two or three moves before that. No, anyway. So, since then, you know, I had a long history on the white side of this, you know, and at some point I was running a tremendous score. I guess after you play this against Ivanchuk, then you're not afraid of anyone else. Some point I had a score, actually lost to my good friend Alex Shabalov, one game. It was the only game that I had a loss on the white side of this. And I had like 14 or 15 wins with some draws. But then the young player, the Cuban-American Julio Becerra Rivera, he lives in Miami now. He got me the US championship. So it was my second loss, but no, I mean, it was more than 20 years between the losses, so it's okay. Well, there is the this move. That's what Vinay played against. I actually didn't expect Vinay to play d takes c4. And now, what's the purpose of this move? Well, if you go here now, right? Then they take. And after this move, they don't play b5 yet. They play this first. And push your bishop back. You can't sacrifice now, because the knight is not attacked yet. If you sacrifice the knight, you'll simply play the bishop there, protect against the pin, and we'll have an extra piece. After the bishop is forced back here, then comes b5. How do you name this? Now, well, I mean, the h6 variation, which has been known since, I would say, the 1970s, probably. It was popular, you know, in the 1980s also I saw a lot of it. And that was white would take, because he didn't think that it was possible to go bishop h4. Later, they started playing this, so that was the Moscow variation, they call it. So, there is a Meran variation, there is the anti-Meran, there is the Moscow variation, which is anti-Meran, and this is the anti-Moscow variation. So there are four antis, you know, that go on top of one another and makes my head spin, okay? Anyway, when your head spins, you know, you better play a safe move. So I took. Actually, I was on the white side of this bishop h4 too a few times. But I, frankly, I don't believe, you know, in this order. Lately, on the top level, Kramnik played it against Anand. Older than Anand plays it with black. And he scored some important victories, you know, in this World Championship tournament that he recently won in Mexico City. So, oh well. Now I take. Okay, let's take stock here, you know. So, I parted with my bishop, right? What did I get in return?
Queen side squares, they're kind of
development a little bit, right? I don't know, the queen side, you know, I don't think there are any squares for me to infiltrate to yet. To me, it's mostly development, because the queen is the only piece out, right? Maybe a misplaced queen. Mm-hmm. Well, we value development a lot, but this is no King's Gambit, obviously. Not even the Sicilian. Hard to attack, right? What's the most natural move to play here when you have a lead in development? What do you want to do? Open
develop
more
castle. Develop a piece.
Yeah, but for that you have to open some. So what would you do with white? The most natural move here.
E3.
I would say E4 is the most natural move, because you have a lead in development. You want to break it open. You want to get your pieces out. You challenge the center. Plus, you know, you play e3 on the white side of this Queen's Gambit decline. Then you play the bishop out and you prepare e3, e4. You do this because that knight is there on f6. Now, it seems like you don't need it. You can go e4 and one go. Well, what happens then is this. Gives you this check. This is an unpleasant check, right? See, normally when you have a bishop back there, it's nothing. You just play bishop d2, you say thank you. Help my development. Help me to get to this square with the knight. Let's exchange the bishops. Now you no longer have the bishop to exchange for this guy. So what do you do?
Knight c3.
Yeah, knight c3. Well, believe me or not, you know, this move has been played by grandmasters. This is how much people want to have the development. King up, no big deal. It's actually a playable move. It's been played on grandmaster level. I mean, yeah, it makes you cringe. Yeah, exactly. Well, I know. What do you think?